And you've got your worm, your sword. I know somebody who lives in his home forgot. This is my Bible.
This is my Bible.
It's my love letter from God.
My love letter from God.
Shows me who I am.
Shows me who I am.
It shows me who He is.
It shows me who He is.
Gives me confidence for victory.
Gives me confidence for victory.
This Bible shows me.
This Bible shows me.
I am drenched in the showers of God's amazing,
unconditional love for me,
and of His rich kindness. That sort of went down. And of His rich kindness.
Declaring, well,
wife, I'm a mother. Yeah, those are important. But the divine exchange is more important. If we would just start to see that we can live from constantly being greatly blessed, highly favoured and deeply loved. I want to go through some scriptures, please, in Romans 4. Rod started talking about Abraham. The Bible tells us that Abraham was blessed to be a blessing. Abraham, the Bible says, is the father of the faith. He's the father of us, if you like. He's got some things to show us that we can walk in that fullness. He was a friend of God. He walked in all the blessings that were possible. He was one of the wealthiest men on the planet. He had livestock, he had servants, he had gold, he had everything that he needed to live a good, prosperous life under God. He was a man without the Holy Spirit. He was a man without the Word of God. We've got so much more, but he's got so much to teach us if we just grasp hold of who we are, because he has shown us. He's a representation of Jesus before Jesus came. So I'm going to read some scripture and we'll just see where we go. Ladies, you got some of this on Tuesday. Well, I should bless you, give it again. But who knows where this is going to go. All right. Verse 1. Abraham was, humanly speaking, the founder of our Jewish nation. He was a founder of the Jewish nation. Think about that. You say, well, that doesn't really apply to me then, because I'm not a Jew. I don't belong to the Jewish nation. Well, as a child of God, we've come into the covenant of God. Amen. But it'll show a little bit later that he's also the father of us, the Gentile nations, of the church. He's the beginning of what God was doing in our life, in our lifetimes. What did he discover about being made right with God? There, for a start, is a question that comes. What did Abraham know that he was right with God? Do we just know that we're right with God because we've been told, or because it's become a revelation? Have we allowed ourselves to divine exchange in this whole area, that we have a rightness with God to live in every day of our lives? What did he discover about being made right with God? If his good deeds had made him acceptable to God, he would have had something to boast about, but that was not God's way. For instance, the first question, who are you? Who am I? It's not about anything that I've got or anything I've done. If I tell you, well, I'm a pastor, and all of this, that's not going to get me anywhere with God. Because we're all kings and priests in his thinking, in his economy. So that's not the answer. And this said that if Abraham had looked at all the things that he did and did right before God, then he'd have something to boast about. But that isn't what got him to be right with God. That didn't help him become right with God. But that was not God's way. For the scriptures tell us Abraham believed God, and God counted him as righteous because of his faith. God told us in, I think it was in John, he said, Jesus was asked, what must I do to work the works of God? And he was told, only believe in him whom God sent. Believe in Jesus. Believe in the finished work of the cross. Believe that what Jesus did on the cross for you and for me is finished and it is done. So from this day forward, I can say I live according to, I am greatly blessed, highly favored, deeply loved. I walk according to the fact that his His riches and glory have been poured out, that I am living from the place that I am greatly blessed. According to Ephesians 3, do you hear what I'm saying? We need to stop believing we have a divine exchange, but not living in that exchange. It's so easy to know some of these things with our head knowledge and then just to live in an ordinary way. Does that make sense? We're, as kings and priests, we have such a higher calling to walk in than anything that we've experienced at this stage. The highest call in the world is to live as a child of the king, to live as a king in the kingdom. But so often we live under the stuff. We don't allow ourselves to be lifted to who we've been created by God to be. So many of us are living way below everything that Jesus Christ purchased on the cross. Way below. He did so much more for us. Rod was sharing with something with me that he heard on a tape. He was not on a tape, it was on a CD, sorry. Tapes are obsolete. I've got a box full of them. But he was sharing this with me. A man of God who is now an older minister of the gospel. When he was a new Christian, he had a situation where he was believing God for this and for that and for all the rest of it. And his dog got run over. And it died. And so he got before God and he said, God, he did everything that he knew to do. He laid hands and he did this and he did that and he did all the other things to raise this dog and nothing happened. So he said, all right, God. He said, I'll make a deal with you. He said, you raise this dog up and I will serve you. How many of us have said, God, if you do such and such, yeah, don't give me a show of hands. And in a little while, he felt this voice say, so you're saying that me raising my son wasn't enough for you. Think about that. So often we try to bargain with God about our earthly things, and yet Jesus himself paid such a price to give us so much.
Hallelujah.
And he gave it to us to walk in. He gave us a divine exchange. The most amazing exchange. And he gave us victory. The Bible tells us that we can live in victory, according to Corinthians, that we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. I think that's good news. But we live so much from our natural thinking, and it's so easy. We forget to believe what Jesus has done. That really hit me, that story about the dog, because so often we do that. And it's so far below what Jesus has done. So far below all what he has done for us. Let's go on. Verse 3. For the scriptures tell us Abraham believed God and God counted him as righteous because of his faith or because of his belief. God counts you righteous because you believe that Jesus Christ paid the price for you. Amen?
Yes. Amen.
When people work, their wages are not a gift but something they have earned. Is that right? How many people go to work and don't expect to be paid? Your whole life, you spend more time in that workplace than you do in the things of God or in God. I know you take God with you, but you know what I'm saying? Please don't take that out of context. But you do expect at the end of the week to get paid. Is that right?
Yeah, I do.
Otherwise, you wouldn't bother going, would you? I'm not sure. Verse 5. But people are counted as righteous not because of their work, but because of their faith in God who forgives sinners. David also spoke of this when he described the happiness of those who are declared righteous without working for it. Oh, what joy for those whose disobedience is forgiven, whose sins are put out of sight. Think about that. Two things. Disobedience has been forgiven. Sins have been put out of sight. Yes, what joy for those whose record the Lord has cleared of sin.
Amen.
It's powerful. And yet sometimes we live kicking ourselves because we haven't done the right thing. Just me. Verse 9. Now, this is what really we need to understand is, now, is this blessing only for the Jews or is it also for uncircumcised Gentiles? It's for us as well. Well, we have been saying that Abraham was counted as righteous by God because of his faith. I'm sorry if you're getting confused. I'm reading from the New Living Translation, okay? Just because it reads so cool. And I just want you to hear just the wonder of what Jesus has done for us. And when it's just done like a story, it really impacts. It opens up a whole new way of thinking about these things. Now, is this blessing only for the Jews, or is it also for uncircumcised Gentiles? We've been saying that Abraham was counted as righteous by God because of his faith, or because he believed God. You've got to imagine Abraham. He's a worshipper of the sun. He lives in the middle of the desert. All he's got around him is heathens and heathen gods all over the place. And all of a sudden, God starts talking to him. Think about it. How did he know that this was the real God? How come they didn't lock him up thinking he'd lost the plot? Think about it. He didn't have what we've got. We've got this word written down. We've got the Holy Spirit. We've got any amount of help to understand that God is God and what Jesus did on the cross. Jesus hadn't been to the cross, but Abraham, a man who lived in the most heathen time on the planet, believed God when he spoke to him. That's amazing. And then, after he believed God and God said, okay, I count you as righteous. Think about this. Then God said to him, I want you to go and circumcise yourself. Come on. Ouch. Think about it. He believed what he was hearing, and then God had the audacity to say, go cut yourself in a very personal, sore place. Come on. And do all the boys around you. Oh, yeah, they're just going to sit there and take it, aren't they? Yeah. And we struggle to believe when God says he's going to provide our every need according to his riches and glory. We haven't got half of what Abraham, he believed. Know that I would be very happy if Rob came to me and said, God has told me, I don't know who God is, but to go and cut myself and all these other people. I mean, come on. Think about it. He's living in a time he didn't have what we've got. He's not thinking about it. But you see, we can skip over what God is telling us so easily and not register how much Jesus Christ has given to us. How much he gave to us in the finished work of the cross. It is amazing what he poured out upon us. Abraham believed this being that was talking to him. And he went ahead and he did it. And he was called right by God because he believed what God said. We've got all of this. Let's live in the divine exchange. Think of the adventure that's ahead of us when we believe this. If he says we're blessed, then guess what? what we healed. If he says he'll sort out your family, then guess what? He will. Some people don't believe that. Well, we have been saying that Abraham was counted as righteous by God because of his faith. How did this happen? Was he counted as righteous only after he was circumcised, or was it before he was circumcised? Clearly, God accepted Abraham before he was circumcised. He didn't have God say, well, you've obeyed me. It wasn't about what Abraham did, it was about what God did, and it's about our believing him. Everything comes down to believing. There are so many of us that we want to believe what we want to believe instead of believing what he said. Oh, well, my opinion of it is this. No, it doesn't matter what your opinion is. We've got this. Believe that. If he said he would provide for you, he will provide for you. Otherwise, he's a liar. The Bible says he can't lie. There's a couple of things God can't do. He can do most things, but there's some things he can't do. Number one is he can't lie. Number two is he can't put sickness on you. Number three is he can't put poverty on you. Why? Jesus took it to the cross. Well, a couple of us believe it. You see, God's not our problem. Our own stinking thinking is our problem. Because we decide that we like to hold on to our own ways of doing it. I am quite sure that when God spoke to Abraham about being circumcised, Abraham didn't want to do it. We've seen a little bit later on that Abraham didn't always do everything right. Yet he was still called a friend of God. He was still called righteous in front of God. Verse 11, circumcision was a sign that Abraham already had faith and that God had already accepted him and declared him to be righteous. I want to go on a bit further, so let's just read down quickly and get to some other things because we're running out of time. Even before he was circumcised. So Abraham is the spiritual father of those who have faith but have not been circumcised. They are counted as righteous because of their faith. And Abraham is also the spiritual father of those who have been circumcised, but only if they have the same kind of faith Abraham had before he was circumcised. Clearly, God's promise to give the whole earth to Abraham and his descendants was based not on his obedience to God's law, but on a right relationship with God that comes by faith. When you believe God, you've been given the whole earth. Do you know that Jesus Christ didn't come to save the earth as it was? He came to redeem us. He came to redeem the people. He came to set people free. And that means us. If God's promise is only for those who obey the law, then faith is not necessary and the promise is pointless. For the law always brings punishment on those who try to obey it. The only way to avoid breaking the law is to have no law to break. Get in a car and find out. You go over 40 out here when the school's moving, and you've broken the law. That's it. You've broken the law. You go over 15 normal times, you've broken the law. If there was no sign up there with a number on it, you wouldn't be breaking any law. You see what I'm saying? The only way not to break a law is not to have a law. But it wasn't about the law, it was about believing God. It's about believing God, not his rules and regulations, because in the New Testament, Jesus Christ paid for it all. He gave us the finished work of the cross. He fulfilled the whole of the law for us. Amen? Verse 16, so the promises received by faith is given as a free gift. And we are all certain to receive it, whether or not we live according to the law of Moses. It belongs to you and me. The promise, what is the promise? That you are blessed to be a blessing. And I like that. You're blessed to be a blessing.
Amen.
You're not blessed to hold it to yourself. You're blessed to be a blessing. God wants us to live with this whole attitude, hey, I'm greatly blessed. Let me just love on you. Let me just tell you how good God is. Let me just show you some kindness. Let me give you a smile. Let me be for you. Why? Because I'm blessed to be a blessing. When I go to Adele and I say, how are you going? She doesn't say, oh, well, you know, it's this and it's that. She just says, I'm blessed like you. And I look at it and think, yeah, it's how we all should be. We're blessed. Yeah. We're greatly blessed. Why? Because the King went to the cross and gave an exchange of his life for our lives. He took our sickness on that cross. He took our poverty on that cross. He made a divine exchange. He didn't have to do that. He paid the price. He didn't say, Sue, now you've got to obey every rule in the book. No, he said, just believe me that I took it to the cross and that I have given you life and life abundance, that I have given you my wholeness. Just believe me. Start living as a king. Start living as a priest on this earth. Why? Because the world needs to know. And the world is crying out for the children of God to rise up and be all that Jesus purchased. We must become the people. We're not this poor little just going to make it to heaven. Heaven's going to be highly populated. Devil's not winning. Move over, I'm coming in. We must become a people that know where we're going. Yeah. Do you think as that child grows up in England that he's not going to know he's going to rule that nation one day? He's designed, he's trained in all of his life to be a king. You've been trained to be a king or a queen, to be in the kingdom of the Almighty God. I think it's exciting. So the promise is received by faith. It is given as a free gift, and we are all certain to receive it, whether or not we live according to the law of Moses, if we have faith like Abraham's. For Abraham is the father of all who believe. This is what the scriptures mean. When God told him, I've made you the father of many nations. This happened because Abraham believed in the God who brings the dead back to life and who creates new things out of nothing.
Amen.
So you might say, I've got nothing. Guess what? He creates new things out of nothing. Are you believing God for a job? Then he creates it for you.
Amen.
New things out of nothing. You don't have to take second best. You're a child of the King. Start walking in the fullness of who you are. Start ruling and reigning on this earth with the power and anointing of the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Be who you are. If you've accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, then you belong to the King. You have been taken into the kingship. You have been taken into the throne room. You've been taken into his palace. You belong to the family.
Yes.
And the family doesn't have to be. Is that right? My family don't have to come with trepidation. Can I please talk to you? Unless they've done something wrong. You know, overall, my grandsons wouldn't even think of that. They come barging through the house. If anything, they eat. No, man, it hasn't, but that's beside the point. They're always hopeful that someone left some biscuits behind. You see, you're part of the family. You belong. You belong there. It's your right. It's your right. You don't have to fear. Bible says, come boldly to the throne of grace and receive mercy and grace for help in this time of need. Come boldly to your Father. Stop hiding from him. So many people run away when they're hurting. We've trained ourselves to walk down and hold it contained within us. Worst thing we can do, expose it. Expose it. It breaks its power when we expose it. Always breaks its power over us when it's exposed to the King. Okay, quickly, quickly. Even when there was no reason for hope, Abraham kept hoping, believing that he would become the father of many nations. For God had said to him, that's how many descendants you will have. And Abraham's faith did not weaken, even though at about 100 years of age, he figured his body was as good as dead, and so was Sarah's womb. Abraham never wavered in believing God's promise. That's not right. The Old Testament said Abraham burst out laughing. But because he believed God, God in the New Testament had it read that he didn't waver in faith. And that's how God sees you. When you believe God, even if you blew it yesterday, when you believe God, he sees you as not wavering. Isn't that awesome?
Amen.
You don't have to go back to last week to fix it up. You just have to say, God, I believe you. I don't know how, but I believe you. Because God looks and sees you with the eye of faith. He sees you as a winner. He sees me as a winner. He sees us as a winner. Good. He sees us as his children winning.
Awesome.
I like to be a winner.
Yes.
Don't you? Well, you are because of what Jesus did on the cross for you and for me. And it just finishes off and it says, in fact, his faith grew stronger, and in this he brought glory to God. He was fully convinced that God is able to do whatever he promises. And because of Abraham's faith, God counted him as righteous. And when God counted him as righteous, it wasn't just for Abraham's benefit. It was recorded for our benefit too, assuring us that God will also count us as righteous if we believe in him, the one who raised Jesus our Lord from the dead. Isn't that amazing? He wrote it for us. Jesus was handed over to die because of our sins, and he was raised to life to make us right with God. Thank you, Jesus, for what you did. Now, our part in all of this is to let go of us and come into that divine exchange. Let God be God. One of our other songs was, it's all about you. But I guarantee most of our lives is all about me. Or all about you. No, let's change our mentality to it being all about him. Guess what? You can't help but win when it's all about him. Let's all stand. Father, we thank you. Lord, we thank you that you've just poured out so much upon us. That by the cross of Jesus, you have given us life and life abundantly. And Father, we just ask you to forgive us for not living in the fullness of everything that you've given to us. Lord, we choose to live in that divine exchange for breakthrough in every area of our lives. Father God, we give you praise and we thank you for Jesus. We thank you for the cross. We thank you that you paid the price so willingly that we could live in the fullness, that we could live in the kingdom, that we could live as kings and priests on this earth under you. Lord, we thank you for what you did for us, that you paid the price that we could have right standing with you. every moment of our lives. Lord, even if we've blown it, even if we've made a mistake, Lord, you see us through the eye of faith in victory. And Father, we give you thanks for it. In Jesus' mighty name, amen.